hey, it's nice that YouTube is processing my videos again. That's great. Because we are going to take on something that may be near and dear to many of your hearts in this video. That is bills. Money, bills. Okay, what do we need money for? Bills, right? So I have this terrible problem with the situation, have for a long time, and have run out of time and can't pay my bills, at least only a few days left. So I said, you know, let me keep trying. I read Journey Beyond Words. Jesus mentioned something about money, and I'm trying to get a handle on it. We tend to like pray for money. Please, God, can I have money? It hasn't worked at all. In fact, it's a spectacular failure. So the Holy Spirit suggested, hey, listen, try this. Say, I don't have a bill problem. I have a continuity problem. The bill problem doesn't exist. It has absolutely no value to me. Only the vision of oneness has value to me. I don't have a bill problem. Now, this is a completely different way of looking at it. And when I looked at that, I felt several things. One, it's like, oh my God, I don't want to give the secret away. Nobody will have bill problems. And it's like, because in this world, as I've said in the previous video, I haven't named it yet, about the abyss. We're all afraid of the abyss. We think that if we let go of our definitions, we create reality through our definitions. If we let go of all our definitions, there'll be an abyss. There's no reality. We protect ourselves from the abyss in many, many ways. We try. One of them is to think that other people are closer to the abyss than we are. And one of the ways that we do this is we try to have more money than somebody else. And one of the most intense ways is the usury, of course, is to lend money to others, charging interest, exorbitant interest on that. And the game there is like, for instance, for me, like I'm super close to the edge, to a financial abyss right now, ready to fall off the abyss, actually, teetering and ready to fall off. This makes other people seem way more secure than me, like, huh, you know, they gotta feel, whew, you know, wow. Yeah, they fell and I didn't. See, they fell because they didn't have the money to pay bills, but I got a lot of money, so I'm safe from the abyss. So we're playing this game. Fact is, there is no abyss at all. There is no abyss at all. But we set up money to symbolize nearness and farness from the abyss. So I'm here ready to fall into the abyss. But at the same hand, I'm thinking, you know, at least those people over there with money, they're safe from the abyss. So at least I feel some, even though I'm falling into the abyss, I feel some safety from it, knowing that there is a way to prevent it. You just have a lot of money, and you know, to pay your bills. So in some way, as you fall victim to this dynamic, at least you feel in the dynamic there's some hope. That's part of it. So if we say, I don't have a bill problem, I don't have any bill problem at all, there is no bill problem, doesn't exist, you're basically saying the dynamic that seems to protect us from falling into the abyss doesn't exist. You see how tricky it is? Why I've had such trouble cracking this nut. This is a tough nut to crack. And I know people are asserting that, you know, they assert all these affirmations. I have money, I'm getting more money. That doesn't really talk to the root of the problem at all. Not at all. So I refuse. They said, no, that's not it. Let's really crack this nut. There are no bills. I don't have a bill problem. Nobody has a bill problem. There is no bill problem. The bill problem doesn't exist. Never will exist. The only problem there is the continuity problem. That's it. And so if we can try this, let me try this. This is about all I have left to try. And see how that works. Deny that there's even a problem. Don't ask for a solution to the problem. It's like saying, I'm in this pit. Can you help pull me out of the pit? Oh, here's the money to pull me out of the pit. Great. Instead, we say, there is no pit. I'm not in any pit at all. There is no abyss. I'm not teetering on the abyss. There is no abyss at all. It's not like I need money to save me from the abyss. There is no abyss. So the way to do that is there are no bills. One moment. Okay. There are no bills. You see, this is a completely different approach. This is the non-dual approach. There are no bills. The bill problem doesn't exist. The bill problem does not exist. Now, you may be saying, hold on, you know. Okay. But let us keep saying this. The bill problem does not exist. I do not have a bill problem. I have a continuity problem. The continuity problem is the only problem that I have. The bill problem does not exist, therefore it has absolutely no value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. Again, I do not have a bill problem. I have a continuity problem. The bill problem doesn't exist, therefore it has absolutely no value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. Again, we can say in general, there is no bill problem. Our only problem is the continuity problem. The bill problem doesn't exist, therefore it has no value for anyone. Only the vision of oneness has value for us. Only the vision of oneness has value. It's the only value there is. The bill problem doesn't exist, has no value. The only value there is the vision of oneness. That's it. Now, we're saying, okay, this feels good. This feels good. We're not used to thinking this way, are we? Now, if a way to pay bills comes, it's not a paying bills, it's a way of saying that the bill problem doesn't exist. Now, understanding we're honoring time here, so it will seem as if there's money to pay bills, but what we have to do is come from the root of saying, no, this is a way of saying the bill problem doesn't exist, has never existed and never will exist. There is no bill problem. So the whole dynamic, you're letting go of the whole dynamic of money, the entire dynamic of money, as a means to protect you from the abyss, because we're saying there is no abyss. It doesn't exist. So ultimately, we won't need money at all. We won't need this world at all. We won't need any of this. But we're holding on to it through this money game, through this bill game, okay? Through this scarcity game, through this resource game. This is all just holding on to defenses against the abyss. That's what it is. So we need to deny that there is any abyss. I do not have an abyss problem. I have a continuity problem. The abyss problem does not exist, has never existed, never will exist. Therefore, it has absolutely no value, absolutely no value. Only the vision of oneness has value for me because it solves the continuity problem. This is what we need to say. And so specifically, I do not have any bill problem whatsoever. I do not have a bill problem. I do have a severe continuity problem. The bill problem absolutely does not exist, never existed, never will exist. There is no bill problem. Therefore, it has absolutely no value. Only the vision of oneness has value. Okay, so hopefully this has got your attention, because this bill situation, usury, you know, that it's intense in this world. It is one of the most intense dynamics we have, actually. And what we're doing is we're really trying to knock this out. I'm trying to knock it out before it knocks me out, actually. And everything I've tried so far in my life hasn't worked. So I'm putting my effort into this to knock it out. And maybe you can get the sense too. But remember, we like to keep these defenses because we say even if we're getting bitten by it, you know, it can bite someone else also. And we can be safe too. It represents safety to us. Just because, you know, we're falling, it still represents safety to us in our minds, you see. So what we have to do is knock that out entirely. Why? We don't need the safety, because there isn't any abyss. We don't need the safety of having more. Okay, the whole idea of money is having more than someone else, isn't it? More. I've got more. If there was no need for any more, there'd be no need for any money or things or anything, actually. All has everything. To say that there's money means there's scarcity. More and less means more and less. And so we play this game of more and less, believing that having more protects you. It actually doesn't. I've seen some there's always instances of really wealthy people succumbing to terrible situations and dying, actually. I'm aware of one in particular. It's really quite incredible. Someone had it all, and still, there was a way to completely bring them down into death. Because you have more, somebody else wants that more too, right? They want it more than you. They want to push you into the abyss and get your more. So this whole money game, no matter how much you have, it's still a nightmare. I'm telling you, it is still a nightmare. Oh, I was at the car wash yesterday, a couple days ago. I may have said this, and somebody told me. I said, hey, you know. He said, I work on commission, and I was getting the lowest cost car wash. I said, sorry, you know, I can only afford this right now. He said, it's okay, don't worry. I said, well, you got a lot of rich cars, a lot of rich people, really nice cars. I'm sure you're going to make a lot of commission. And he says, you know what? That's not true. He says, as a matter of fact, the richer the people are here, the stingier they are. He says, I said, oh, wow, you know. That's what everyone tells me, and that's what I've noticed, that they fight over every little penny, a lot of them. You know, they just don't want to give anything to anybody because money represents safety to them. Yeah, this is what a lot of people have told me. I think it's a truism. And then I told them, well, that's how they got rich, fighting over every last little situation, competitive. I got to win this. And you do that millions of times, really, just constantly. And you'll think you've you know, developed a lot of safety net. Now maybe I've been saying to those thumb of my nose, I don't need any safety net. But if you still are of this duality consciousness, then you're gonna still think there's an abyss there, and you're still going to deny any truly miraculous way to pay your bills. You see. We're afraid that if we have our bills are paid miraculously, that it's not out of our control. It's coming from God, and we're afraid that no, God's the abyss. You know, we're thinking God's the abyss. It's only what we define God as, and I'm not defining it as that. We want to control what happens to us, so that's part of it too. We're just kind of throwing everything we got at this the bill problem. So I've always acted like I don't have any scarcity at all. And yet, I've always been virtually penniless, or actually deeply in debt. So it hasn't worked. So I'm looking at why has it not worked. Because I'm still holding on to this idea that money can buy safety. Money can buy safety. From what? From the abyss. Safety. In saying, I don't have to drop my definitions and thinking and interpretations and definitions. You do it. You know, you're poor. You know, I'm not going to give you a penny. You know, you do it, and you be the guinea pig, that kind of thing. And so, it could be that I've been pressured to do that, like to be the guinea pig. Saying, well, I have to do it. You know, I have to do it. So there's a lot to this issue. It's really a very intense issue that we have to look at here and knock it out. It's like a very tricky pitcher. You need to hit a home run off this pitcher. So I do not have a bill problem. I have a continuity problem. A continuity problem is the only problem there I have. It's the only problem there is. The only problem there is the bill problem doesn't exist, and therefore has zero value to me. Only the vision of oneness exists. Only the vision of oneness has value. Only the vision of oneness has value. So it is possible, I'm surmising, to accept this in spirit. And when you accept it in spirit, it's like the whole money thing's out of your hands, which is kind of scary for most people, because even though you're like poor, or in debt, you're still thinking you can bounce back and make $1 million, right? Always. And then you say, well, I'll be safe and happy then, for sure. So I don't want it out of my hands. You know, I don't want the spirit controlling it. Because like I might you know, end up with not more than other people. You know, or I don't know what's going to happen. It's scary because we think money is safety. Our control of money is safety. That's how we look at it. So it's a very scary thing to relinquish money to the Holy Spirit. But that's what we're aiming at to do. What the Holy Spirit tells us is we'll always have enough. We'll always have enough. Whatever the Holy Spirit, in the flow of this life here, whatever the Holy Spirit has us doing, we'll always have, there won't be any bill problem. So we're dropping the bill problem. We don't have a bill problem. See, we're not saying I have a bill problem, but I want $1 million to solve it. Because once I solve the bill problem, then I say, hey, I want to get like a lot more, $10 million, you know, like that. That's not what we're saying. We're saying we don't have a bill problem at all. There is no such thing as a bill problem. We're not saying give me money to solve the bill problem. We're just saying there is no bill problem. This is a different way of going at it. And I'm just surmising that somehow bills get paid, but it's not like you're getting rid of a bill problem. You don't have a bill problem. It's just evidence there is no bill problem. There will never be a bill problem. Okay, this is where we need to go. There will never be a bill problem. I will never, ever have a bill problem. It's impossible for me to have a bill problem. The only problem I can ever have is the continuity problem. The bill problem, I can never have the bill problem. Therefore, the bill problem will never have any value for me whatsoever. The bill problem will never, ever have any value for me whatsoever. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. That's the only value there is. So this is how we're going at the whole situation here, is to use this continuity technique. And I am kind of a guinea pig for this, but a willing guinea pig. But I certainly have to knock this situation out. And it's giving away the secret. You know, this is giving away the secret, so to speak. That means nobody will have a bill problem once they all learn this, which means I'll never have more. You know, there's no more or less. There's no way to judge based on money. And judgment to us seems to be safety from the abyss. Judgment seems to be safety of the abyss. So it seems like, wow, we're taking on this issue of the abyss always. And whatever we do, we're taking on the issue of the abyss. That is true. So underlying the bill issue is the abyss issue. Absolutely it is. So as you weaken the abyss issue with a continuity practice, then you're able to look at the bill situation, also weaken that. It's practical. I do not have any bill problem whatsoever. I have a continuity problem. The continuity problem is the only problem I have. It's the only problem there is. It's the only problem there will ever be. There's never been any other problem except the continuity problem. The bill problem doesn't exist. It has no existence. It's never existed. It doesn't exist and will never exist. There's no such thing as a bill problem. Ever. I can never have a bill problem. I will never, ever have a bill problem. Therefore, a bill problem has absolutely no value. Totally valueless. Totally valueless to me. Only the vision of oneness has value. The vision of oneness is the only value there is. There is no other value. There never will be any other value. So, the value right now is the same value there will always be. The problem right now is the exact same problem there will always be. And that's it. Won't have any other problem, any other value. So this is giving out the secrets, you know, so nobody can ever be in debt to me, you know, I can never be in debt to someone else, no one else could ever be in debt to me, there's no way for me to be, you know, a a usury. You have to use usury on anybody. Anyone can escape the whole goal and think that you can pull everybody else into that, because I'm giving out the key to how to escape that, actually. Not how to escape it, but how to acknowledge that problem doesn't exist. You don't have that problem. It doesn't exist. I do not have a bill problem. I have a continuity problem. The bill problem doesn't exist, therefore has no value for me. Only the visual oneness has value to me. Yeah. So that's the thing. I was like, wow. You know, I'm telling people how to be free. So there's no way that you can control them. You can be controlled financially, right? It's financial freedom. It's freedom from finances, ultimately. And so the whole, you know, in the back of our minds, think, wow, maybe I could be some clever credit card issuer person, you know, and get everybody indebted to me and be a multi-billionaire, you know, and just have all this safety. Wow. But now it's released to the world that this is how you avoid this, sidestep it, nullify it. This is how it's completely nullified. So there's been reluctance on my part, on everyone's part. Nobody's really talking about how to deal with this. I think in the back of their mind, they all want to be billionaires, you know. But isn't it better to say it's impossible they can ever have a bill problem than to be a billionaire? Isn't that better? I think this is what we have to look at carefully. Because even billionaires end up bankrupt, right? And in all sorts of legal hassles. Your spouse will divorce you, sue you, claim you're mentally incompetent, take over your business, sell the business. I mean, lawsuits and huge, you know, problems. It's a nightmare. And you still get Alzheimer's and you're still, right? So, no matter how much money you have, it doesn't protect you from finances and bills. You know, the whole dynamic of that. But what we're saying, there is no dynamic of that. I'll never have a bill problem. Never, ever have a bill problem, effortlessly, without even trying. I can't have a bill problem. It's impossible. There is no such thing as a bill problem. Remember, the bill problem is just a projection of our continuity fear, unacknowledged continuity fear. But if we own our continuity fear entirely, own it all, and say, yeah, I've been afraid of the non-existent abyss. There is no abyss problem. There's only a continuity problem. Vision of oneness is the only value there is. Meaning, I have a fear of pure happiness. I have a fear of pure freedom. I have a fear of what I am. That's fine. That's being honest. Then the whole universe rushes in to help you with the continuity problem. Because it's an actual problem. It's an actual problem. It's an actual pragmatic problem. The only real problem there is in terms of pragmatism. How do I resolve that continuity fear so I can accept that there's never been any abyss? There's no abyss for anyone. The abyss doesn't exist. It's impossible to ever fashion an abyss. All I can do is hallucinate an abyss, but there's never any abyss actually at all. Nobody is in danger of falling out of reality. Therefore, everyone has everything there is. It's impossible for there to be any lack of abundance, any bills. It's completely impossible. So we say it's impossible to have a bill problem. I acknowledge it's absolutely impossible to have a bill problem. Nobody can have a bill problem, ever. Wherever we go, we'll always be exactly where we've always been. Whatever we have, we'll always have everything. Whatever we have, we will now. Whatever we seem to have, we will always have everything. Whatever we have, we will always have everything. Wherever we go, we will always be exactly where we've always been. It's impossible for us not to have everything. All is all. All is all. And that's it. All is all. So far, so good. So far, so good. So you really can't get one up on anyone. You can't get one up. There's no one up. All is all. Wherever I go, I'm always exactly where I've always been. wherever you go, you're always exactly where you've always been. Wherever all is, all is exactly where it's always, always is. All is exactly where it always is. All is exactly where it always is. So we think that this bill money thing is like so real that we can't get free of it. There's definitely in this world that's the feeling here. And so up till now, I've never been able to crack this nut. Even though Jesus assures us it's just as easily crackable as any other nut, actually. You don't need any of this. Truly, we don't need any of this whatsoever. It's only our honoring of our time. It's honoring our creativity is all that it is. But whatever our creativity is, it's always exactly, we're always exactly where we've always been. Now, he talks about creativity, and he says our creativity here is actually always interpretation of the past. What he says is we have a brief glimpse of experience, and then experiencing. And we have a brief glimpse of experiencing, and then we turn into experience by labeling it, defining it, and we think that these new definitions, new labels, is creativity. But it's still... It's still a reaction to the past, a snapshot, so to speak, a snapshot. It's not true creativity at all. It's merely interpretation, labeling an interpretation of a snapshot of experiencing that we had. And then we're thinking that we're being creative because we're having new labels and interpretations. But it's just still the same thing. It's still interpretations. We're still interpreting. We're still defining. Still defining. It's like, hey, I got a new definition of experiencing. Oh, you're very creative. that's not experiencing. It's not experiencing. So, we have to I'm not explaining it as good as Jesus does here. I'm trying to get the gist of it. He refers this as the past or time. Because it's not experiencing, it's an experience. Experience is then something framed in time that you had an experience at this date, moment. Well, first we take the snapshot and then we react to that snapshot. So we're actually reacting to the past, it's correct. We're reacting to the past. If it's not the present, it's the past. Because the eternal present, there's always eternal present. If we're not experiencing the eternal present, we're looking at an experience of the past that we see that is set in time. Okay. It's not happening now. And then we're getting clever definitions of that past and saying, excuse me, saying we're being creative, saying we're being creative. That's not real creativity, he says. Okay, all right. Okay. Let me take a little break. I'm gonna reset and see if I can go at this again, real with intensity. Okay, just a minute. I don't have a build problem. I have a continuity problem. Build problem doesn't exist. Therefore, has no value. Only the vision of oneness has value. So we will continue with this. I'll continue a little later with the video and hit it real hard. For some declarations, affirmations in a little bit. Okay. Be right back. All right, as promised, I will continue on with this money bill issue here after sleeping on it. I did actually get some money today to pay the bills unexpectedly. It's not how I thought it would turn out, but what I want to do is get to the root of the situation, which is, keep in mind, you must declare Nobody has any bills. There's no such thing as owing anything. The bill problem doesn't exist. No one has a bill problem. There is no bill problem. It's very important to say this. Nobody owes me a penny. Nobody owes me anything. Nobody owes me anything. Okay. This is really close at the root of it, even more than anything. Because if you think you owe somebody, what are you keeping alive? You're keeping alive the whole principle of owing something. In reality, it's impossible to owe anyone anything. Completely absurdly impossible. Everybody has everything. Everybody has instant access to whatever they desire, whatever they want. How can anyone owe somebody? The notion is utterly ludicrous. How can you give something to somebody that they don't have? And therefore, how can you claim that someone owes you? So, well, I gave you this. Therefore, you owe it back to me. I can't supply whatever I need, whatever I want to experience through my own spirit. I need more from you or something. There's no such thing in reality. This is so utterly without any foundation in reality. It's just amazing. The idea of money and owing doesn't exist in reality. Therefore, it doesn't exist at all. So, no one owes me anything. No one will ever owe me anything. So this is a declaration. Declare it. Nobody owes me anything. No one will ever owe me anything. It's impossible that I could ever be owed anything. It's also, no one is, you can say, no one is indebted to me, right? No one is indebted to me. It's the same thing as owing me. No one is indebted to me. No one will ever be indebted to me. It's impossible that anyone ever be indebted to me. Okay, here we're getting to the root of it. No one is indebted to me in the slightest way. No one will ever be indebted to me in even the slightest way. It's completely impossible that anyone could ever be indebted to me in any way. There's no such thing as indebtedness. Indebtedness does not exist. Therefore, indebtedness has absolutely no value to me. Only the vision of oneness has value to me. Now as a bonus, so let this settle in. Well, maybe we just continue with this. I am not indebted to anyone. I have no indebtedness. I will never have any indebtedness. It's impossible for me to have any indebtedness. There is no such thing as an indebtedness. Therefore, indebtedness has absolutely no value to me. Only the vision of oneness has value to me. Okay. This is the basic, you know, form of exercise is you declare, and then you also no value to what doesn't exist, and then you say what does have value. The one value there is the vision of oneness. No one is indebted to me. Nobody could ever be indebted to me. Indebtedness does not exist. Therefore, indebtedness has no value. Only the vision of oneness has value. Yes, 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 yes. I'll just keep this one on bills and money, and I'll do another video on something that is incredibly wonderful news. I don't have a bill. You don't have any bills. I don't have any bills. You don't have any bills. No one has any bills. The bill problem does not exist. The bill problem does not exist. Therefore, it has no value for me. It has no value for you. It has no value for anyone. I can never have a bill problem. You can never have a bill problem. No one can ever have a bill problem. The bill problem doesn't exist. Therefore, it has absolutely no value to me, to you, or to anyone ever. Only the vision of oneness has value. Only the vision of oneness has value. Well, these are super, super, super duper helpful to do this. You don't even know how helpful it is, actually. It's really, well, it's evaporating the continuity fear to an extraordinary extent. No one owes me anything. Nobody can ever owe me anything. It's impossible that I'd ever be owed anything. The owing problem doesn't exist. Oh, therefore it has no value to me or to anyone. Only the vision of oneness has value. Yes, yes, yes. You just keep working on this. It's very important. Indebtedness doesn't exist. Indebtedness does not exist. Bills do not exist. Indebtedness does not exist. Money does not exist. Okay. I don't have a money problem. I have a continuity problem. The money problem doesn't exist, therefore it has no value to me. Only the vision of oneness has value to me. The indebtedness, I do not have an indebtedness problem. I have a continuity problem. The indebtedness problem doesn't exist, therefore it has no value to me. Only the vision of oneness has value to me. Yes, yes, and yes. Now, again, I give time to let this sink in. I just can't keep hammering incessantly. There needs to be just a time to catch your breath here. This is very profound. No one can be indebted to another. It's impossible. There is no indebtedness problem. The indebtedness problem doesn't exist and can never exist. Nobody can ever be indebted to another. It's absolutely impossible. Indebtedness problem doesn't exist. Therefore, it has no value to anyone, ever. Only the vision of oneness has value to everyone, always. Only the vision of oneness has value to everyone, always. It's just the same thing as victim-victimizer. Indebted, you know, debtor and indebted. The indebted one and the one that is owed money. The creditor. The debtor and the creditor. It keeps alive the idea that someone can owe somebody something. Just like the victim-victimizer keeps the idea alive that somehow there's a lack of safety in reality. That loss is possible. And we said indebtedness is possible in reality. So it makes a mockery of reality. It's a denial of reality. Now, if there was no debtor-creditor, right, there would be no bills, no nothing. So you need both. You need two for the dance. You need victim and victimizer. You need debtor and creditor in order to assert a lie about reality. This world, of course, is just a training ground for us as we trying to train to prepare to be greater than God. This is what we feel is a necessary training ground, where we believe that reality is at the mercy of definitions of reality. We feel that we're trying to learn that definitions are prior to what's being defined. That is what this crazy situation, our thoughts and thinking and memory and time, and you know, that we believe we're practicing. Everything is at the mercy of definition. All is at the mercy of definition. So we're prior to definition. We're controlling reality through definition. Through interpretation, structure, definition, how we define it. We think reality is at the mercy of our definitions. And so we're practicing that here in this world. So we practice more and less, you know, debtor, creditor, trying to fracture the isness, the all is allness of reality. We're practicing that too. We're practicing to define the isness as more and less, meaning that which is greater than isness, and that which is less than the greater. If you say greater is automatically lesser, so but we're practicing greater, so the debtor, you know, the creditor has greater leverage over the debtor. Okay, the debtor owes the creditor, see, as if the creditor doesn't have everything, right? And as if the debtor doesn't have everything. Why would someone need to borrow money if they had everything? And why would someone need to loan money if they had everything? Why would they even insist on it being paid back? It's ridiculous. This whole realm is completely ridiculous. We don't even need this realm. It's a training ground for what will never happen. So we don't need it. It's not needed. The realm of the flesh is not needed at all. Only those who want to turn their back on reality and pretend that this turning their back means that they're training to be greater, and they're you know, they're going to be greater eventually. And the fact that they're trained to be greater already makes them greater, you know. That kind of pride. But all this training is for naught. It's never will result in being greater. Always there's the fear of the abyss and the defense against the abyss. And attempt to fracture that abyss through less and more. Well, there's more abyss, less abyss, you know, debtor, creditor, victim, victimizer, duality. We're stuck in this duality as defense against the imaginary abyss that we feel we'll be plunged into if we drop our definitions of reality, thinking that reality is dependent on our definitions and our thinking. We think if we stop our thinking about reality, thinking and imaging, reacting to images, snapshots, experience instead of experiencing, we'll be plunged into an abyss. Reality is the experiencing. Continual, continual, continual. Seamless, always now, it's just a constant flow. There's never any snapshot where it's static. It's always alive. The light is living, it's a living light. Light is not something static, it's living. It's always living. It always retains its quality of pure responsiveness. That's what we call life. What we call living is the pure responsivity of light, along with the desire, the will of spirit to experiencing. Those two are, you know, that's what life is. That's what life is. And life never loses its livingness, actually, you see. But by our thinking, we think that it's a dead thing. And that life is the thinking, that thinking and defining is life, and that reality is a dead thing that only gets its form. It's a form, it gets its form from our thinking and defining. But this is an imaginary kingdom that we're conjuring up, and yet we think without that there's an abyss. So we could be saying that we're trying to escape the fear of the abyss by more and less, continually more and less, like, okay, you got more of the abyss, I got less. Well, if you got more and I got less, maybe it's not an abyss. Maybe there's some structure there. Maybe we can define it here. Let's define it, you know, with this dualistic way, victim, victimizer. Okay, you're going to be cast in the abyss because you victimized me, but I'm not because I was a victim. So people here say, no, I want to be a victim. Actually, what I've found is people who want to be victims, they feel that's the right play for them. That's a smart play. Because they feel that the victimizer is the one who's going to be cast out into the abyss, and that they've paid the price to not be cast into the abyss, you see. It's the story of the crucifixion of Jesus, where people have interpreted it as meaning those who accept the victimization, oh, he was victimized, and we're all we all accept that victimization, we won't get cast out into the abyss. It's the victimizers, the one that did this, those are the evil ones. They will be cast out into the abyss like that. So we love, this world loves victim status. It absolutely loves victim status. In fact, it does everything it can to get victim status. It pleads for it, it begs for it, begs for it. If you don't do it, they'll get more and more insistent. No. Because for them, that's safety. That's safe, that's the price they pay for safety. So if you say, no, I'm gonna treat you with equal love, they say, no, you can't do that. You can't do that. No, that's the abyss to them. Sameness is the abyss. You know, they're trying to, you know, dualistically say, no, the abyss is over there. It's not here, it's over there. I'm a victim, so I'm not in the abyss, but you're the victimizer, you're in the abyss. These are the mind games that we play here. So, I have no debt. No one has any debt. No one can ever have any debt. Debt is impossible. Debt is impossible. Therefore, debt doesn't exist. Debt does not exist. Debt is impossible. Debt does not exist. Therefore, it has no value for me. It has no value for anyone. It will never have any value. Only the vision of oneness has value. It has value for me, it has value for you, it has value for everyone, and always will be the only value there is. The vision of oneness is the only value there is. Yes, and yes, and yes, 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 yes. I can never be indebted. You can never be indebted. Nobody can ever be indebted. Indebtedness does not exist. Indebtedness can never exist. Indebtedness does not exist. Therefore, it has no value to me or to you or anyone ever. Only the vision of oneness has value. Yes, 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 yes. No one owes me anything. No one can ever owe me anything. No one owes you anything. No one can ever owe you anything. No one owes anybody anything. No one can ever owe anyone anything. Owing doesn't exist. Owing will never exist. There's no such thing as owing, therefore, owing has no value. Only the vision of oneness has value. Yes, 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 yes. So we're just getting our feet wet with this and showing how it is possible to make declarations of truth and evaporate the continuity fear of what? I'll deal with that in another video, but of what exactly are we so afraid of? Well, we've been playing the fool for so long, the fool of definition, a fool of, we can turn everything to stone, static stone, to non-experiencing. We can turn light to non-experiencing by definition, you know, by perception. Perception shows us what we want to see. So I perceive to be asked the light to pretend to be dead for us, and that's what it's doing. We think we're greater than God because we killed the light. So we've been so foolish for so long. We're so used to snapshots we call experience. I had this experience, I had that experience, that's memory, I had all these snapshots. We're not living, experiencing right now. And we're terrified of that because it's a continuity issue. You go from dead, static, snapshot, thinking-ness, experience, bearing, to seamless, flowing isness, nowness, experiencing is like going from pitch darkness to the bright, shining sunlight. And that's called the continuity problem. And everybody has a severe problem with that. Everybody does. You don't just leap into absolute purity. You need to, the next step from this vision of oneness is there always for us. But we can be helped towards the vision of oneness, actually, in various ways. And that's what we're preparing for. We may be find ourselves experiencing tremendous beauty in another realm, or in the mind's eye. There's certainly something coming up, and I've been shown what that probably is, so I'll talk about that in another video. But we have this astonishingly terrible continuity fear, and so it's gradualism, bit by bit by bit by bit by bit. But certainly you cannot be participating in this collective experiencing where our creativity for beauty, your desire for beauty, is all blended with everyone else's to be forming this living responsivity of light that just produces this incredibly flowing, beautiful display for us. You know, you cannot be doing that if you're thinking about debt. Who owes you money? Or who do you owe money? And how do I get something, you know, to pay, you know, some thingness? You see what I'm saying? So you have to release everybody from owing you anything, because otherwise your mind will be on, well, how do I, you know, get this payment? I need this payment. I need a payment from somebody. So you have to release everyone from owing you anything ever. Okay, this is the most important step. In order to participate in the next level, what's available to us, which I've already seen, I was shown that. You cannot have this issue of debt as far as somebody else owing you anything. And therefore, of course, you have to realize that you don't owe anyone either. But they certainly, more importantly, they can never owe you anything. Therefore, you never try to take a snapshot of this beauty and then say, let me go to the earth, let me show them this beauty, creativity, beauty, and they're going to have to pay me a lot for this. You know, they owe me for this. And they'll say, oh boy, yeah, this is better than what I have. How much do I owe you? You know, and give you money so you can buy other things. None of the things have any relationship to the beauty that you were seeing, including the snapshot. It totally misses the experiencing. That's why you must give up what you think is creativity. It's not. It's not. What we've been believing to be creativity is not creativity. And the creativity that we believe we've been using here has been used to try and get other people indebted to us so that we can protect ourselves from the abyss. Thinking, well, I've got a lot of money, a lot of reputation, a lot of prestige. I'm safe from the abyss. And the others that owe me, they're to be cast into the abyss. At least I have a lot of people indebted to me. So I say, God, I cannot go into the abyss because other people owe me money. Well, what you're really saying is, I cannot go into the experiencing of reality because a lot of people owe me. See, it's a double-edged sword that keeps you from evaporating the continuity fear effectively. As I've said, the light has stepped itself down many levels, maybe five different levels. And you need to go back towards home, towards the pure light, the pure clear light, through these other levels, experiencing there until you get familiar with that, and then you go on to even more beautiful experiencing. Not experience. You're not labeling or defining your experiencing, because it's always right now, and it's always a collective. It's always a collective. As Jesus says, the collective activity of the oneness is so beautiful beyond comprehension that here in this world where you're struggling to do things by yourself, you can't even imagine how great it is, how wonderful it is. So we have to get used to that, start to get used to that. And we'll start out very simply, very easily, is what has been shown. It's something we can do. It's something we can do. Not in this world, so to speak. Not in this physical plane. Not in this way things are. Here, it's a farce. It's a farce here to try and mimic, you know, what the higher realms, what is possible there, the purity there. Absolutely, the purity. There's no decay, no death, no degradation. You know, everything's just shimmering, fresh, and clear, and utterly responsive. You know, just like. And that's just the next higher level than here, you know. But here, you know, it's to try and mimic it is ridiculous. Why do that if you can? It's like you want labels, play with labels instead of actually experiencing what the label's referring to. It's like playing with the labels of water instead of drinking the water, and thinking that playing with the label words water are somehow superior to drinking the water, or somehow give you the experience of drinking the water. It doesn't. Experiencing, oh, I'm drinking the water, doesn't give you that. So it's stupid, it's foolish to demand representations, creative representations of the higher realms here. What you need to do is experience the higher realms. It's easy. In your mind's eye, you can imagine it, actually. You can imagine the astral realm. You can imagine the beauty of it, just simply, you know. And that's just the beginning. Now, we try to mimic that here in movies and into creative artists, designers, and everything, but that's a farce. Here, ultraviolet light is deteriorating everything. Everything's crumbling. Everything's turning into dust here, you know. Because the light is pretending to be dead here, because we asked it to. In order to justify thinking that the definition is superior, you see, in order to justify it. So don't ask someone to give you a fish, ask them to teach you how to fish. That's all important. Teacher won't give you a fish. They say, hey, I'll teach you how to fish. So debt must be denied. Debt must be denied both ways. There is no debt. I'm not in debt. You're not in debt. No one is in debt. Debt is impossible. Debt doesn't exist. It will never exist. There is no debt. Therefore, debt has absolutely no value. No value. Only the vision of oneness has value. So I'll try to bring this up in other videos as we go forward, because it's so important. You know, if you do owe a lot of money, how can that, you know, evaporate? How can that evaporate? Do we need to have it evaporate? Now, one more issue here. In the dream last night, it's very important. I saw along the side of the property here, I suddenly looked and so there's all this activity and all these 2x2 posts were there, so many, and I said, whoa, wait a minute, there's all this construction activity. I said, what's going on? I saw a worker there. I said, what's going on? I said, oh, we've been contracted. I said, why, what's going on? I said, we're building a fence. I said, how long did it take? Oh, probably, you know, about a week, maybe a little less than a week. I looked and I saw, you know, there's this huge post here, and then all these smaller two by two, but they were like 12 feet high or more. At least 12 with pointed ends to them. And I said, wait a minute. Is this a fence or a stockade that you know, is being built here? I was just observing and saying, wow, wait a minute. Now keep in mind, once you get the posts in for a fence, you can put the rest of the fence up in a day. It goes very quickly. It's putting all the posts in and the header and the footer, getting that all ready and squared, all that work. But once that's done, boom, 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 boom. One day, the entire fencing is in. So you can, actually, fences, I've seen professional fence people put in fences very quickly. A day or two, they've done it, boom, they're finished. So fences can are something that can, that will go extremely fast. This fence that I saw is a stockade. It's a stockade. Is a prison. A stockade is something to keep livestock inside or something. It's intended to keep us deluded in a prison where we cannot look over the fence and see the next realm, the higher realm, where experiencing is possible. Okay, the light is actually responsive in real time to our thinking. It's responsive here, but remember, we asked the light to pretend it's not responsive. So it's being responsive to that request. So it seems as though it's not responsive here, but in the next realm, we drop where we, the realm where we drop that demand that light be non-responsive. Then we get to play with the light collectively and enjoy this, you know, just amazing beauty that light can present. And I've tried to represent that here in this world, but it, such efforts have just been, you know, futile. I did videos on like light and water and stuff that were like incredibly beautiful. Some of the things I've done are some of the more beautiful work I've ever seen in this world. But still, it's an absolute faint pale echo. It doesn't really give the experiencing. It doesn't really speak to it. It's better to imagine it within your own mind's eye, based on lack of continuity fear. When your continuity fear drops away. And when you've been invited into this realm, actually, which I have been, then you feel like, yeah, I can start imagining, getting a sense of what's it going to be like, what's it going to be like. So we have this stockade. As I said, the ideological war in this world is going very rapidly. And very quickly, there'll be this blackmail, there'll be this pressure on the world, and it will be as if a fence has gone up. And we look around and say, oh my God, I can't escape. They are literally fencing us in ideologically. We're being fenced in. And this will happen way faster than people realize. So the timetable is a matter of days, probably. It's a matter of days. I don't know exactly. It's less than a week. I don't know what a week refers to in a dream necessarily. You know, but it could be a matter of days. I don't know. Could be the way the acceleration is happening. For me, I've been invited into the higher realm. Been given a direct invitation. And I said, yeah. I'm not afraid of that. We say, nobody owes me a penny. Nobody owes me anything here. Because people here, they say, oh, we can't do that, we can't do that. We got to give us a representation of that. See, light is dead. It's not responsive anymore. You don't realize that. So if you want to help us make beautiful things that remind us of the beauty of that, so we can keep making more beautiful things here, but the light is not responsive anymore. That's their belief, because they've turned their back and they refuse to look. This high stockade fence represents the desire not to even look at the higher realms, to cut everyone off from the history, the lineage of spiritual attainment, the history of explanations and clarifications. So we'll just be hedged into materialistic consumerism and focusing on what we think is the dead light and how we can force the dead light to appear to be beautiful to us, you know, using force and stuff. That's not where it's at. That just gives you the static dead experience. The static dead experience. It's not the living light of experiencing at all. Which we are created for, that living light of experiencing. So no debt, I have no debt, you have no debt, no one has any debt, no one owes me anything, no one owes you anything, no one owes anyone anything. There is no debt, there is no credit, there is no debt. Credit and debt do not exist. Bills do not exist. Money does not exist. Therefore, bills, credit, money, do not exist. Do not exist and have no value. Bills, credit, debit, money have no value to me, have no value to you, have no value to anyone, will never have any value. No such value exists. No such value exists. Only the vision of oneness has value. Only the vision of oneness exists for me. And keep in mind, we are incredibly close to something happening here in the world. It should happen in August. Okay, in this August, I would say. And I'll keep you up to date. Keep you up to date on the next step. I will explain something in the next video, which would be is really tremendous. Okay, that's it.